Good day, everyone. Today's lecture is going to be on plate tectonics, and this begins our Chapter 2, Series Number 1 lecture. So, the theory of plate tectonics is a theory that took over 50 years to become accepted in the scientific community. That's quite a long time, and it's a really good example of the scientific method at work. Prior to 1960, most geologists believed that the positions of the continents and ocean basins were actually fixed. They did not move around. Then in 1915, the hypothesis known as continental drift was proposed by Alfred Wegener. So with this proposal of continental drift from 1915 until the 1960s, all of the research was done was incorporated into what we now call plate tectonics theory. So Alfred Wegener was the gentleman that proposed the continental drift hypothesis. And what this said was that a supercontinent named Pangaea existed 200 million years ago. And then it began to break apart. And the continents sit today where they are from the breakup of Pangaea. In the bottom image, this is Wegener's idea of what Pangaea looked like, and he was actually quite close. However, a more modern reconstruction of Pangaea has Asia just a little bit different in position. So what evidence was there for continental drift? What was Wegener so convinced that these continents, these lithospheric plates, were moving around? Well, one of the big lines of evidence came from the apparent fit of continents, like pieces of a puzzle. So here we're showing South America and Africa, and if you close up the Atlantic Ocean, what you end up having is quite a nice fit of the two continents. Other lines of evidence included fossil evidence. We have this Mesosaurus, who is found, fossil remains found in South America as well as Africa. Now, this was a freshwater organism that could not have swam across the Atlantic Ocean. So this suggested that Africa and South America were once connected. Other evidence includes Lystrosaurus, Glossopteris, which was a fossil fern, and you can see the locations of across various continents that these fossil remains are found. So Wegener interpreted this to mean that the continents were once all one. This is an image of some ideas of how fossils could end up, or organisms, the remains of organisms can end up on other continents. So in this image up here, some suggested maybe they just rode across on a piece of wood, or maybe there was a narrow piece of land that connected the continents, or maybe the island stepping stones that they jumped across a large ocean to get to another continent, or continental drift. Additional evidence in support of continental drift was the matching mountain ranges on continents. If we close up the Atlantic Ocean here and bring the continents all back together, what scientists have found is that the mountain ranges are similar. Similar rock type, similar structures. Climate evidence. Well, down in the southern hemisphere, the climate evidence included glacial evidence. So today, we see glacial evidence on these continents here. If we put these all back together, these continents back together, this is what it looked like. Now, the movement, the striations that the glaciers leave in the rocks, they are simply grooves in the rocks, indicate the direction of motion of the glacier. And they're all the same on the continents and where they sit today, indicating they were all once together. More evidence, coal swamps. Coal swamps are located across the northern hemisphere, but 200 million years ago, those continents were more along the equator, and this is the conditions, the environment that would be needed in order to form coal. So, why did no one believe, or not very many people believe, Wegener's idea on cotton mill drift? And the answer is that he didn't have a mechanism for drift. In other words, he couldn't explain how it was happening. He had a couple incorrect ideas, such as gravity caused it, or the continent simply drove through the ocean crust like an icebreaker. And so, as a result, he simply was not taken seriously because he didn't have an explanation of how these continents could move. So, there was actually strong opposition to the hypothesis, and he ended up dying in 1935 without his hypothesis being accepted. Following World War II and the study of the seafloor, new evidence came to light to support continental drift. For instance, the oceanic ridge system was discovered, and in fact, it winds through all major ocean basins. They determined that there was an ocean crust that was no older than 180 million years old. Rocks on the continents have been dated at over 4 billion years old. So why is ocean crust so much younger? They discovered additionally that there was a thin sediment accumulation in the deep oceans and a thicker deposit along the edges of the ocean basins. So with the discovery of all of this new information, eventually this was rolled into what we now call the theory of plate tectonics. So let's take a look at when we talk about plate tectonics in this diagram. We're showing ocean crust and continental crust. Remember, ocean crust is thin compared to continental crust. What is the lithosphere? The lithosphere is a physical layer of the Earth that encompasses all of the crust, whether it's oceanic or continental, along with the uppermost mantle. And they describe it as being a strong, rigid layer. Existing below the lithosphere is a weaker layer called the asthenosphere. And because of the different physical characteristics of the litho and asthenosphere, you can imagine the lithosphere and asthenosphere effectively being detached from one another and allowing the layers to move independently. This concludes our lecture, part one lecture of chapter two, plate tectonics theory.